Hello, welcome to this video on AC examples. We'll go over a number of examples of analyzing AC circuits. We'll see how we can combine both numerical solution of AC circuits and phasor solution of these circuits. And we'll show you that all the techniques that we learned before, like current division, voltage division, mesh analysis, nodal analysis, and so on, they all still apply to the case of AC circuits, but the only difference is that everything is a complex number. Okay, so let's start take a look at some of these examples. Okay, we are giving this circuit here. We have a resistance R of value 3 ohm, and it is in series with an unknown impedance ZL. So this impedance ZL here, and the resistance 3 ohm. And we're given this phasor diagram as well. This phasor diagram shows the phasor of the source voltage. So this is the source voltage. And it shows the phasor of the voltage across this impedance ZL. So the impedance is called ZL. And the voltage across it is called VL. And using this shown circuit and the phasor diagram, would like to find IS and ZL. Would like to find the current flowing in this circuit. Okay, and would like to find also what is this impedance ZL here? What is its value? Is it capacitive or inductive? What is the value of this impedance? Well, we can solve this problem in two different ways. The first one is using the phasor analysis. The second one using numerical analysis. Let's try first take a look at the phasor analysis. We're given VS, so this is VS here, and we're given VL. But from the phasor diagram, from the circuit itself, I can simply write that VS is equal to this voltage here, which is equal to VR, okay, plus VL. So if I want to get VR, I have to subtract VL from VS. So how do I do subtraction phasors? I will start from the end of VS, and then I will move in the direction opposite to VL. Okay, and then I will draw a vector with the very same length. So if you do that, maybe you can try to do it. It's not going to be very accurate because I'm doing it with a hand, not with a ruler. So it's going to look something like this. So this vector here, this phasor that I drew here is minus VL. So this is VS minus VL. And the result of VS minus VL must give you VR because VS is equal to VR plus VL. So now we know that this vector, this phasor here, so I'm drawing it, okay, this one here is VR. So because things are drawn to scale, I can simply say from this figure that VR is 3 angle 0. Because you can see it's fully in the direction of the real axis, and it has no component direction of the imaginary axis. Actually, positive imaginary this way. This is negative imaginary axis, okay? So this is telling me that VR is equal to 3 angle 0. But R is 3 ohm, then I can tell that VR is equal to the current multiplying R. Then the current is 1 angle 0 because the resistance is 3 ohm. So let me repeat this one again. From the phasor diagram, we found that the phasor of the voltage, the resistor voltage is 3 angle 0. It is this one here. But the resistance is 3. And by definition, and from Ohm's law, we can tell that IIS, I can simply write it this way here, IS is equal to VR over R. Okay? So this one is 3 angle 0, and this one is 3. And we know that the voltage and the current in a resistor, they are in phase. So this means that the current 3 angle 0 over 3 will be 1 angle 0. So I was able to tell that the current will be 1 ampere with an angle of 0. So we can write it this way. It's 1 ampere angle 0 degrees. This is equal to IS. Okay? I was able to find this one from the phasor diagram. Notice that you can also take the information from the phasor diagram and then convert it to numerical values. For example, I know that this phasor here, you can see, it has 4 units in the positive real axis. It has 3 units in the negative real axis. So this phasor is 4 minus J3. This phasor has 1 unit in the positive real axis and 3 units in the negative imaginary axis. So this phase is 1 minus J3. So I could have done the same steps exactly numerically. So I will show you that in the next slide. So just remember this one here is 4 minus J3, and this one is 1 minus J3. How did I obtain these numbers? I obtained them from the phasor diagram itself. Okay, so we can proceed to do a numerical solution. We got Vs. Vs from the phasor diagram is 4 minus J3. VL from the phasor diagram is 1 minus J3. But I know from the shape of the circuit itself that I have the resistor, and then I have ZL here, okay? And this is Vs. So I know that Vs is equal to Vr plus VL, okay? Plus minus, the same way we do it for resistors. So I know Vs, I know Vr, I can get VL, I can get Vr. Vr is equal to Vs minus VL. And you should notice sometimes I forget to put the tilde on top of these phasors, but again it should be understood that these are all phasors. They are all complex quantities and they represent sinusoidal signals. So if you subtract these two, 4 minus J3, if you subtract it minus 1 minus J3, you'll end up by 3 angle 0. So the voltage across the resistor is 3 angle 0, but the resistor value is 3 ohm. Then I can, because I know from our discussion before that the voltage in the across the resistor and the current in the resistor, they are in phase. So if I want to get the current, I divide the voltage by the resistance. 3 angle 0 by 3 angle 0 will give me 1 angle 0 ampere. We divide the two amplitudes, subtract the two phases, so we end up 1 angle 0. If you want to find ZL, well, we know VL. VL is given from the phasor diagram. Is 1 minus J3. I know the voltage across it. I know the current going through it now. This is the current going through it. Then I can know what is this impedance. So this impedance would be the voltage across it divided by the current through it. It's 1 minus J3 divided over 1 angle 0. So this will give us 1 minus J3 again. Remember, when you divide by 1, nothing really changes. Otherwise, I would have had to convert this one to polar coordinates and then divide the two amplitudes and then subtract the two angles. But here, because I'm dividing by 1, nothing has changed. 1 minus J3 divided by 1 will give you 1 minus J3. So this is really how the circuit looks like. A resistor of value 3, and this is ZL. These two combined are ZL. A resistance of value 1 ohm. And an impedance of value minus J3. It represents a capacitor. Remember that the impedance of the capacitor is minus J over omega C. So here 1 over omega C is equal to 3. Okay? But here the frequency is not given and you don't need to know what the frequency is. We just have to work with complex numbers and realize that all these complex numbers represent phasors at a specific frequency. Okay, let's take a look at another example. We have this circuit here. It has 4 components, 2 resistors and 2 inductors. This is a resistor of 10 ohm, 20 ohm. These are 2 inductors of impedances, of impedances J2 and J6. And we have here 1 current source. Its amplitude is 18 and its phase is 45 degrees. So we'd like to find the voltage VAB. The voltage VAB as a phasor, of course, for this one, it's a very simple circuit. We have 1 current source, and we have 4 components. So this branch is in parallel with this branch. Okay, so we can apply the expression for current dividers. So I can simply define a current here. I call it I1, and define a current here. I call it I2. And then apply the expression for the current dividers. So I1 will be equal to this total current, multiplying this total impedance, divided by this impedance over 30 ohm. Okay? Remember, the current divider, we use the opposite ratio. So I1 will be equal to this current, multiplied by this impedance, which is J8, divided by J8 plus 30. The same thing, I2 can be found. I2, the current flowing in this branch, is equal to the total current multiplying 30 ohm, divided over 30 ohm plus J8. Okay, this is a typical voltage divider, current divider. And once you have find the two currents, I1 and I2, I can simply use them to find the voltage VEB. And the easiest way to do this is to simply say that the drop between here and here, I know it. I can call this point here X. So I know what is VAX. And I also can find the voltage drop between this point and this point. So I know the current going through here. Then I can multiply this current by this impedance. This will give me this voltage, which is VBX. If I subtract VAX minus VAX, will give me VEB. This is simply coming from Kirchhoff voltage law, that VEB is equal to VAX minus VBX. Okay, so if you go around in this loop here, you see that this satisfied. So the first step, get I1 and I2. Once you have find I1, find VAX, the voltage between here and here, the voltage across the 20 ohm, multiply I1 by 20 ohm. Once you have find I2, find VBX, the voltage across the J6 ohm, multiply I2 by J6. Once you have find VAX and VBX, subtract them, and then you get VEB as an application of KVL. Okay, so let's do the calculations we summarized in the previous slide. As I explained, I defined two currents. I1 will go on this branch, I2 will go on this branch. They are both sinusoidal currents. They are represented by phasors. So I1 is simply equal to the current I multiplying J8 over J8 plus 30. This is what we have here. So I1 is equal to I multiplying Z2 over Z1 plus Z2. It is the opposite ratio, as we explained before, in current division for resistive networks. This current here is given to us. This is 18 angle 45 degrees. This one, these two here are J8. And the sum of J8 plus this one here will give me J8 plus 30. And when you multiply complex numbers like this in this form, it's better to convert them to polar form. So J8 is nothing but 8 angle 90 degrees. And as I explained in classes, J is an angle of 90 degrees. Minus J is an angle of minus 90 degrees. 30 plus J8, we can find the modulus of this one, square root of 30 squared plus 8 squared, and the angle is the inverse tangent of 8 over 30. And if you do that, you obtain this modulus and angle. 31.04, angle 14.93. Okay, now the multiplication is very easy because we multiply all the polars, all the amplitudes, so 18 by 8 over 31.04, this will give you the modulus. 45 plus 90 minus 14, this will give you the angle. So we, again, when we multiply two polar forms of phasors, we multiply the amplitudes, and we add the angles. And then when we divide two complex numbers in polar form, we divide the amplitudes and then we subtract the angles. So here the result for the modulus or for the amplitude will be 18 by 8 over 31.04. And the angle will be 45 plus 90 minus 14.93. So 45 plus 90 will give you 135. 135, you subtract from it 14.93, you obtain 120.1 degrees. 18 by 8 over 31.04 will give you 4.64. So now we know both these currents, and of course these currents are all in amperes, so I can put the unit here as amperes at the end. We repeat the same steps exactly for I2. So I need the current flowing in this second branch I2 here. Okay, so this second branch current will be equal to the total current multiplying Z1 over Z1 plus Z2. So Z1 here will be 30, and then we divide over 30 plus J8. So this is the expression for I2, okay? 30 is simply 30 angle 0. It's a purely real number. 30 plus J8, we already found its polar form earlier. It's 31.04 angle 14.93. So now we put in this form. Now to calculate this product, we multiply 18 by 30 over 31.04. we add 45 plus 0 minus 14.93. And this will give us the expression for I2. Okay, so I just rewrote that expression from the previous slide just to make it convenient for you. So again, this is the expression for I2. So the modulus will be 18 multiplying by 30 divided by 31.04. This will give us 17.4. The angle is 45 plus 0 minus 14.93 will give us 30.1 degrees. Now, what remains? I found already I1 as a phasor. I found I2 as a phasor. And both of them, of course, are in amperes. So this one here is a sign, I2 is a sinusoidal signal with amplitude 17.4 and a phase shift of 30.1. And this phase shift will be in the negative time direction. Okay? So now we would like to calculate VAX. VAX is a voltage between these two points, but using KVL, which still applies here, but everything will have to be complex. VAB is equal to VAX minus VBX. You can go around this loop here, and the loop does not have to be closed, of course, as I explained in class, and you'll be able to calculate VAB. VAX, this voltage between here and here, is equal to I1 multiplying 20 ohm. VBX, the voltage between here and here, is a voltage drop across the J6 ohm. So it's equal to I2 multiplying J6. So this is what we're going to say here. VEB is VAX minus VBX. VAX is equal to the current I1 multiplying 20 ohm. And VBX is the current I2 multiplying J6. So we write I1 in polar form. When we are doing multiplication, it's better to do it in polar form. We calculated I1 to be 4.64 angle 120. This 20 here can be written as 20 angle 0. We calculated I2 here, 17.4 angle 30.1. We have it here. And then multiply by J6. Okay, so when you multiply two complex numbers, the modulus will multiply the modulus. So these two here will give me 92.8. You add the angles 120 plus 0 will give you 120. For this one, J means a phase shift of 90 degrees. So this is 6 angle 90. So 6 multiplying 17.4 will give us 104.4. 90 plus 130.1 will give you 120.1. As an approximation, this 120, this 120.1, these two vectors are in the same direction approximately. So I can simply subtract them and the result will be in the same direction. Okay, so I can subtract the two modulus here. Moduli here is at 104.4 and 92.8. So this gives me minus 11.6 angle 120. So I keep the same angle, approximately the same angle. I ignore this 0.1 because it's going to introduce very little error in the result. And when I subtract these two, I obtain this value. Now, one minor thing that has to be changed is that when we write a complex number, we cannot have a negative modulus. This can be like that. So this negative is equivalent to a phase shift of either 180 degrees or minus 180 degrees. Both of them are the same. Okay, so what you will have to do here, you will have to subtract from the phase here 180. So this will give you here 11.6 angle minus 60 degrees. Okay, because I want to keep the modulus as a positive number. Don't keep it as a negative number like this one here. Okay, so now this is written in a more standard form for writing complex numbers. A modulus, a positive modulus, e to the j, the angle, or the way we write it here, angle minus 60. This one here is equivalent to multiplying by e to the minus j 60. Okay, so our result, VAB, is 11.6 angle minus 60. So it is a sinusoidal wave of amplitude 11.6, and it's shifted in the positive time direction by 60 degrees. Okay, let's take a look at the third example. We have this network here. The frequency is not given. I don't care about the frequency. All I care about is the impedances. This impedance here is J3. We know that the impedance of an inductor is J omega L. So omega L for this coil is equal to 3 ohm. This one here is J5, so this means that omega L for this coil is equal to 5. I don't really need to know the frequency because the frequency is already implicit here. They can give it to us, but it's not really necessary for us to calculate the impedances. The impedances are already given, so I can work with these impedances. So what is happening here? We have a source. This source is sinusoidal, so it's pushing current throughout the circuit. There is another source called V1. And V1, I can give it an instantaneous polarity here. And V1 is trying also to push sinusoidal currents all over the circuit. And I would like to determine the magnitude and phase of V1 such that there is no current flowing in this branch. Okay? So this is really the purpose of doing this example. Find V1 such that there is no current flowing here. The current flowing here will be zero. Now, the current flowing here is equal to VAB, this voltage, divided over 2 plus J3, because this is the impedance that we have. So the current flowing here, I'm going to repeat this again, the current I is equal to VA minus VB divided over 2 plus J3. And for this current to be zero, VA must be equal to VB. And if VA is equal to VB, then there is no current here. And then we have two independent loops, one loop flowing here and one loop flowing here. But these two loops are related with the relationship that VA is equal to VB. So if there is no current flowing here, then in this loop, the current is flowing this way. Okay? And this current does not really, none of it will go in this branch. Okay? So what is the voltage VA? What is the voltage VA relative to ground here? We can define this point actually to be ground, doesn't really matter, but we can say this is our ground. I can simply say the voltage between VA and the voltage between VA and this point here, okay, relative to this point, which I'm gonna call it my ground, doesn't matter. V, I can call it X even. I can say this is VAX in the same way we did earlier, is equal to a fraction of this voltage according to voltage divisions. So I can simply say VAX, if I call this point here to be X, if I want to do it that way, I can simply say that VAX is equal to this voltage multiplying J5 over J5 plus 5. Okay, so I can find VAX. Now, what is VBX? VBX is obtained in terms of V1. Because this is 4 ohm, this is 6 ohm. So I can simply say that VBX, again, is going to be a voltage divider. Because if there is a current flowing, it's going to be flowing only in this loop. Because these two loops are now disconnected because there is no current flowing in this branch. I can simply say that VBX is equal to V1 multiplying 6 over 6 plus 4. So if I equate VAX to VBX, which is equivalent to equating VA to VB, then I can get expression for V1. Okay, so we carry out the steps we outlined in the previous slide. So we have here, this is the voltage. We'd like to get VA relative to this point, which we called X. Or I can call it ground. It doesn't really matter. I can put a zero. So then VAX, or VA in this case, doesn't matter, is equal to 30 angle 0 multiplying J5 over J5 plus 5. It's a voltage divider, so I'm able to find the voltage across the J5 impedance. Again, when you do multiplication, J5 is 5 angle 90. J5 plus 5, because the real part and the imaginary part are both real, and they are both positive, then the angle will be 45 degrees. And the modulus is 5 square root of 2. I could do this in the fly. If you're not familiar with it, just take the square root of 5 squared plus 5 squared, and the angle will be inverse tangent of 5 over 5, the imaginary part over the real part. So I can simply write it this way. Now, to simplify this term, 30 by 5 over 5 square root 2 will give us 21.21. 0 plus 90 minus 45 will give us 45 degrees. Now, to have no current flowing in this branch, we have to have this current I equal to 0. And as we said earlier, VB must be equal to VA. So the voltage here relative to this point must be equal to the voltage here relative to this point. So I can simply say that VB is equal to VA, and VB must be equal to 21.21 angle 45. But what is VB? What is the voltage between these two points from this other loop? We agreed there's going to be a voltage divider. So it is V1 multiplying 6 over 6 plus 4. Okay, so this would be VB. And I know what is VB. I know VB is 21.21 angle 45. So this means that V1 here is equal to VB multiplying 10 divided by 6. And this is what I have here. I multiplied it by 10 and then divided by 6. These two are both real numbers. You don't introduce any phase shift. So I get 212.1 over 6, the same angle 45. So I end up with V1 equal to 35.35 angle 45 degrees. So now for these two sources, this source and this source here, to result in a zero current flowing in this branch, I must have that this source equal to 35.35 angle 45 degrees, okay? So this one has an angle of zero. It's a sinusoidal signal, not shifted, with amplitude of 30. This one must be an amplitude of 35.35 and must be shifted in the negative time by 45 degrees. I will verify the same steps I did for that example using a completely different method. I will try to use mesh analysis, and then I will try to force the current I2, which is flowing in this branch, to be equal to zero. If you remember in mesh analysis, we associate a current with every loop, okay? And then we write the KVL around every loop, and then we try to solve for these three currents. So I have a current I1, I have a current I2, I have a current I3, okay? So we write the three equations governing these three currents, and then we try to set to put the condition that I2, which is flowing here, remember I2 is the only current flowing here, to make it equal to zero. So let's write the first equation. This battery is equal to this drop plus this drop, with the same way we used to do it for DC signals. Okay, so I can simply say here that this drop is 5 multiplying I1. This drop is equal to J5 multiplying I1 minus I2. Okay, so we can simply say for the first loop, the 30 angle 0, which is this one here, is equal to 5I1 plus J5I1 minus I2. What about the second loop? Let's go around the second loop. Second loop does not have any voltage sources, but I can simply say that the drop here is J5I1 minus I2. And this drop will be equal to this one plus this one, okay, from KVL. So J5 multiplying I1 minus I2 will be equal to 2 plus J3 multiplying I2 plus 6 multiplying I2 minus I3. Or if I move them all to the same sides, I can simply write that J5 multiplying I1 minus I2 minus 2 plus J3 multiplying I2 minus 6 ohm multiplying I2 minus I3 is equal to 0. So this is my second equation here. Okay, let's go to the third loop. The third loop, I have this here. This is 6 ohm multiplying I2 minus I3 will be equal to this drop plus V1. Okay. So I can simply write it this way, that 6 ohm multiplying I2 minus I3 minus 4 multiplying I3 minus V1 is equal to 0. So these are the three equations that I have, and I will put them in a matrix form in the same way we did before. If you put it in matrix form, this is what you have. The matrix now will be a complex matrix. So you must get used to how to solve matrices with complex coefficients, okay? What we have now is to solve for I2. In order to solve for I2, if you remember, we talked about this in mesh analysis, we can replace the second column here, can replace the second column by this column here, okay, and then solve for the determinant. If I want I2 to be equal to 0, this determinant must be equal to 0. So I have to come here and replace this second column by this right-hand side and set the determinant to be equal to 0. And this will guarantee that the second current is equal to 0. Because if this is using them, this is using the method of determinants for solving systems of equations. To solve for I1, I will have to replace the first column by this vector. To solve for I2, I have to replace the second column by this vector, and the same thing for the third current. So I will replace this one here by this one, and then I set the corresponding determinant equal to 0. So I did exactly that. I got rid of the second column. I replaced it by the right-hand side. And for I2 to be equal to 0, this determinant must be equal to 0. This is from the method of determinants in solving system of equations. Now, let's expand that. This is 5 plus G5 multiplying 0 minus 6V1. So I have that. This is minus 30 multiplying G5 multiplying minus 10. So minus 30 minus G50. This one will give us 0. So this must be equal to 0. This will give us 1500 multiplying J, so G1500. And the coefficient of V1, and if you can see here, I have this coefficient here for V1, which I can include. So if I move this term here to the other side, I can change its sign. So J1500 will be equal to 6V1 multiplying this term. If you multiply 6 by 5 will give us 30, 6 by J5 will give us J30. So this is the expression now for V1. You can, of course, convert it to Bohler. You get J1500, which is 1500 angle 90. 30 plus J30, as I explained earlier, will be 30 square root 2 because the real and imaginary parts are both the same. And then the angle will be inverse tangent of 30 over 30, angle of 45 degrees. So if you divide these two and then you subtract the two angles, you get 90 minus 45 will give us 45 degrees. 1500 divided by 30 square root 2 will give us this number. So this is now the value in volts. And this is exactly the same answer we got earlier using the voltage division approach. Okay, so these two approaches show you that you can use voltage division, or you can use mesh analysis, and by the same token, we can use nodal analysis or Thevenin or whatever theorem we'd like to apply. But we have to take into account that here we are dealing with phasors, and phasors are complex numbers. So everything will require complex analysis.